In this video, we are going to take a look at the perceptron training one step at a time. So in the previous video, we outlined the perceptron training procedure, which consists of a training data set, the initialization of the model weights, and then the iteration over the training epochs, where for each training example, we make a prediction, compute the error, and update the weights and the bias unit. So how does that actually look like in practice? Let's take a look and do it step by step. We will start with making a prediction. So consider our initialized perceptron model here. As you might recall from the earlier videos, we compute Z, the weighted sum, as follows, which is essentially a multiplication between the inputs and the weights plus the bias unit. So once we computed the weighted sum Z, we can then apply the threshold and we say if Z is greater than zero, we output the orange triangle, class label zero, and otherwise we output the blue diamond, which is class label one. Now let's take a look at a concrete example. So since we initialized the model weights with zero, we always have a multiplication with zero here when we start, so the weighted sum will also be zero. So applying this now to our concrete example data set, let's see what happens. So we are here in epoch one, iteration one. Using our threshold, remember that we always compute zero in the beginning because the model weights and bias unit are zero. So what happens is that the weighted sum will be zero and our perceptron will predict the blue diamond for this first data point in the training set, which happens to be correct. So the next steps are then computing the error and updating the weights and the bias unit based on the error. However, since we saw we just made a correct prediction, there is actually no update necessary in this case. All right, let's now go to the next data point. So for this data point, since we have not updated the weights or the bias unit, the weighted sum is still zero. This means for this data point, the perceptron will also predict the blue diamond. So continuing on through the training set, we will see the next predictions are all blue diamonds. So nothing really interesting is happening here. And as a pro tip, I recommend actually shuffling the data set before you iterate through the epochs so that you alternate between data points from one class and the other. Now let's suppose we are at iteration 11, where we encounter our first orange triangle in the dataset. Since we still haven't updated our model weights and the bias unit, the prediction is still a blue diamond. However, in this case, this prediction is actually wrong because the true class is an orange triangle. So in this case, we encounter our first error and we use this error to update the model weights and the bias unit. So shown here are the updated weight parameters and the updated bias unit. We will see later how we actually compute the precise numbers, but for now, trust me that these are the correct weight updates for this iteration. So the weighted sum is consequently not zero anymore, because now we have actual weight values in bias units that are not zero. So if we now provide this orange triangle as an input, the x1 and x2 values that correspond to this training example, then computing this weighted sum involving the data input, as well as the weight parameters in bias unit, our value z, the weighted sum, is greater than zero. Now in this case, we predict the orange triangle, and now we can see that the perceptron makes a correct prediction after updating the model weights and the bias unit. So we can now also construct the so-called decision boundary. Everything on the left-hand side of this decision boundary will be predicted as a blue diamond, and everything on the right-hand side of this decision boundary will be predicted as an orange triangle. If you are curious how we constructed this decision boundary, we will cover this in an optional bonus video. Now continuing on with the iteration 12 in this data set, so for the 12th data point, since it falls on the right-hand side of this decision boundary, we also make a correct prediction. So because it's visually a little bit easier, let's now use this decision boundary to see what the predictions are for the remaining data points in the training data set. So as we can see, all the remaining data points in this data set are orange triangles, which fall on the right-hand side of the decision boundary, which means we are making correct predictions here. Remember the definition of the training epoch. It means that we make a full pass over the training data set. Now, once we completed the first training epoch, we repeat this whole thing and go through the training data set again. So here we are again at training example one, and we can see it falls on the right-hand side of the decision boundary. So this means the perceptron will predict an orange triangle. However, given that the training example is actually a blue diamond, this prediction is actually wrong. So what happens is that the perceptron will again update the weight parameters and the bias unit. But the decision boundary as a consequence will change. You can see the decision boundary now slightly moved to the left. So for the next training example, we again make a wrong prediction. So this blue diamond is also on the right-hand side of the decision boundary. So here in this case, the perceptron will predict an orange triangle, which is in fact wrong. As a consequence, there will be another weight and bias unit update. So now the decision boundary gets the second training example correctly. However, the third training example is now wrong. And as you can see, this is an iterative process, and it's the main idea behind machine learning, where the machine learning algorithm tries to find an optimal decision boundary based on iterating through the training data set. So for this third data point in the data set, as we can see, there's another wrong prediction, so the decision boundary will move again. The perceptron algorithm will continue this game of iterating through the training data set and updating the decision boundary until it finds a decision boundary where there is no update anymore. So we can actually make a small modification to this algorithm so it doesn't run infinitely. We can add a criterion and say that the perceptron should stop once it reaches 100% prediction accuracy. That means that it classifies all the data points in the training set correctly. The perceptron sounds like a very efficient algorithm. However, it has one big limitation. In order for it to stop to reach the 100% prediction accuracy, the data set must actually be linearly separable. So if we have a data set like our toy data set, it is in fact possible to find a decision boundary where we can achieve 100% prediction accuracy. However, now consider we have another training data point over here on the left-hand side. And in this case, it's actually impossible to find a decision boundary where we can perfectly separate the two classes. And this is a case where the perceptron will never stop updating. Still, the perceptron is a very interesting algorithm, and it's a good baseline model in practice. Later on, we will see better algorithms in this class and also build towards deep neural networks, which are more powerful and can also construct nonlinear decision boundary to solve this problem. So in this video, we looked at the perceptron algorithm and the training procedure on a conceptual level. In the next video, we will learn how exactly we update the weight and bias units.